Hello, I'm Michelle Jorgensen, and this is the Mount Mahogany Steak Self-Reliance video. Today we're going to talk about cooking. So in our second and third video earlier in this year, we talked about food, right? Short-term food storage, long-term food storage. Well, that's wonderful, and hopefully you really got started on preparing and saving those kinds of things. The trouble is, if you have that food, you actually need a way to cook it. Now, in normal life, we use our nice electric or gas stoves, our ovens, those kinds of things that are just at our fingertips all the time. And we get very, very spoiled with that because those are real easy ways to cook food. But in any kind of a disaster, we'd probably lose all of our utilities, which would include electricity and gas. So we need some alternate ways to cook with. So the first thing to think about is what kind of foods have you stored and what kind of cooking needs do you have? So if you've stored something like this, you know, this is a pre-prepared chili, you're going to need to just heat it. It's going to be a lot simpler. But if you stored something like this, which is what a lot of us have stored, dried beans. Well, this has to cook for a lot longer. So you're going to need to have a continual heat source to be able to do something like this. And there are ways to cook it and make it go a little quicker, but this is going to take a lot more heat, a lot more cooking. So think about that. What kind of things do you have stored? And one important thing is to store some no-cook foods, things that you don't have to cook at all. Because, and you know, honestly, if I were starving, I'd eat this straight out of the can without heating it up. No questions asked. This would be going down the hatch. So, you know, obviously some of those things, a can of beans, like a green beans, easy, no question I would eat that without cooking it. But think about that. Are there some things that you can actually eat without cooking? All right, so some of the things I want you to think about now as we're starting to talk about alternate cooking methods is, first of all, what things do you already have on hand? You may not even have thought of them. First of all, do you have a fireplace? If you have a fireplace that's not gas, I have a gas fireplace right back there that's going to be worthless, but if you have a real fireplace that uses wood, that's an alternate cooking method. If you have a barbecue grill sitting out on your deck, that's an alternate cooking method. So you may already have some things in place. If you have a fire pit out back that you know hang out at on the weekends, that's an alternate cooking method. So think about what you maybe already have in place. Then I also want you to think about what fuel you have and what fuel do you already have in place. Do you have a wood pile somewhere? Do you already have a propane tank underneath your barbecue grill? You know, think about that. What do I have already? And you may be surprised. You may already have some ideas and some things that you have. The other thing I want you to think about is, do all of your cooking methods rely on good weather? If you're always thinking, okay, I'm going to just use my fire pit out back, well, that's only going to work if it's not raining. So you need to consider, what things can I provide for myself to cook with that are not dependent on the weather? So, some things to store. People-powered appliances, right? Because if we don't have electricity, our electric can openers, our electric blenders, electric food processors, our electric wheat grinders, bread makers, all those kinds of things, they're not going to work anymore. So make sure that you've stored some people-powered appliances so that you can still cook things, still open a can if you need to. The other thing to consider that we don't often think about is, if you're cooking over a fire, if you're cooking even over a barbecue grill, anything of that sort, you're going to need some different kind of utensils. You're going to need a lot longer handles. You're going to need some protection. This one's been used because this is what we use in our outside oven. You're going to need some protection, and you're going to need ways to cook it that differ than what you have now. A lot of our pans have those really nice plastic handles that will melt within one time of cooking over on kind of an open fire. So you need to have some pans and some things that will work over an open fire or over some kind of heat source that isn't just your electric or gas oven in your kitchen. So, excuse me, have a few of those things stored. Now, if you've listened to me before, you know that I'm a big fan of thrift stores. So as you can see, that still has the Desert Industry sticker right on it. This is a dollar from DI. This is where I get all these kinds of things because people don't know that they should be storing them, so they send them to DI and then you buy them for cheap. So cast iron skillets, if you watch, you'll find those there. So a lot of those things you'll be able to find there. Okay, the other thing to consider is safety. So we're going to talk about a lot of different alternate cooking methods today, but very few of them are actually safe to use indoors because any kind of an open flame creates carbon monoxide. It consumes oxygen and creates carbon monoxide. Well, that is the thing that will kill you, right? There's a lot of symptoms related to carbon monoxide poisoning that are insidious, meaning we don't know that they're happening. We just start to get real tired. So make sure anytime you're using an open flame indoors that you have a very good ventilation source, that you're making sure you're continually adding oxygen to your environment. So as that fire is consuming the oxygen, you have more for you. All right, so let's talk about what some of these options are. Inside options, like I said, are kind of scarce. Your fireplace that you already have inside, because it has a flue, a chimney, things that it can go out. It also has air coming in, so that is a good thing to cook over. Butane stove. So this is a butane stove. This is something that could be used indoors. It's very small, it's very portable, it's nice for that reason. The butane goes right over here in the side in little canisters. These are cheap as can be. The real easy place to find these is in the Asian markets. They love these. So you can get one of these for $20. So get yourself a butane stove, buy a case of butane, because obviously the butane is expendable, meaning when it's gone, there's no more butane stove being used. So a case of butane is maybe $10. So for $30, you could have a butane stove and a fairly decent source of fuel that'll last you a little while. In fact, it's estimated that probably one can of butane will last you about a day if you do three meals a day with cooking. And you know, if you think about it, you probably aren't going to use it three meals a day. So a can a day, if you store 30 days worth, 30 cans, it's probably 30 days worth. Okay, so the third option that can work indoors is a thermal cooker. I love thermal cookers because thermal cookers use a little bit of fuel to heat for a really long time. Now there's a lot of different options of thermal cookers. This is called a Wonder Bag or Wonder Box. The very simplest one is called a Hay Box, and what it is most everybody has some kind of ice chest, right? Cooler out in their garage. Well, what you may not realize is that it keeps food cool, but it also keeps food hot. So if you heat something, and there's things, I'll put it all online, recipes and amount of times you need to cook. But for instance, say you're wanting to cook this can of beans. So if I use my butane stove and get it up to boiling, and I boil it for 15 minutes, so 15 minutes is not going to cook these beans, I'll tell you that right now. But if I boil it in a pan for 15 minutes with the lid on, I then take that pan full of beans and I put it inside of my Wonder Bag. I close it up so the pot goes right inside of here, right inside of there. This is very insulated. I put the hat on and close this up and leave it for 4 or 5 hours. Come back, my beans are done. And I've only used 15 minutes of fuel. So that's the beauty of thermal cookers. So you also can use, like I said, an ice chest. So what you do is you do the exact same thing. You cook it in the pan, you put it in the ice chest, you surround that hot pan with towels, with a pillow, with any kind of insulating medium you can. You close the lid on that ice chest and you don't touch it. You don't let that heat escape. What happens is that 15 or 10 minutes of fuel use can turn into 3 or 4 or 5 hours of cooking in some kind of a thermal cooker. There's also versions called Saratoga Jacks. I have a less expensive version that I use. I actually love this thing. I take it on camping trips all the time because I can cook in the morning, 15 minutes, throw it in there. We can head out in the car, and 4 hours later, our lunch is hot as can be when I open that thing up again to have it at lunchtime. And I didn't have to bring my cooking source with me as I did that. So I love thermal cookers. There's a lot of ways to do thermal cooking. I would suggest you look into that one because it's a very inexpensive, very fuel conservative way to cook. That's really the options for inside. That's about it. Everything else is going to have to be used outside. So your barbecue grill is the first one on the list. So hopefully if you have a barbecue grill, there's one sitting on your deck, maybe make sure your propane's full. That's always a little depressing when you turn that on, you can't actually use it. Make sure your propane's full. This is something that a lot of you probably have sitting getting dusty in your garage, right? This is a Coleman stove. Everybody knows what it looks like. Everybody's used it at some kind of a camping event somewhere. This is great, but it cannot be used inside. The other thing that's not so great about it is that the fuel is expendable for this as well. And you have to use white gas or the Coleman fuel to be able to run this. So you have to store it. The nice thing about white gas is it actually stores indefinitely. So you can store that Coleman fuel for a lot of years. So this may be one to store, especially if you already have the stove. excuse me. You may have a fire pit outside. Fire pit's another cooking that happens outside. Solar cooker. This is also one of my very favorites. I have to admit the food tastes maybe a little funny when it's coming out of here, but it's okay because it's cooked. This uses no fuel at all other than the sun. So you put your food inside of it and many hours later, and you have to babysit it a little bit because you have to continually turn this towards the sun so that you're getting the sun's heat in there. But this will get up to 350 degrees inside of here with just the sun. It's pretty incredible actually. So you put food in here and 5 or 6 hours later, you're going to have dinner. So it's something that, you know pretty much it's a disaster. The only thing I have to worry about is keeping myself clean and fed. So life gets pretty simple at that point. You think about food a little bit more, and you put it in at 10 a.m. and you keep it in there till 3 p.m. and your food's cooked by that point. In our fast-paced lives, a lot of times we don't have time to sit and baby a solar cooker for 5 hours. In a disaster situation, we would. So solar cooker, I love. Here's some fancier versions of things over here that are fun to have and fun to use, but not necessarily fuel conservative. This is called a volcano stove. Volcano stove is great because you can use it with briquettes, you can use it with propane, you can use it with just plain old wood, you can use it with a lot of things, and it's very conservative with the fuel. I really like this. Briquettes go a lot further when you use it inside of a volcano stove. It costs a little bit of money, so you know it's one of those things to consider. This over here is called a rocket stove. I think I'm going to go over and get it actually. This is called a rocket stove, and I really, really like the rocket stove, and I'll explain to you why. This uses such little fuel for so much heat output. This isn't going to come off, obviously. But what happens is the fuel goes into this little door in the front. There's a little tiny door that the fuel feeds down into. And you can use just little tiny sticks and things that feed into this little fuel door. And it will heat here. You put your pan on top. You cannot believe the heat that comes out of this thing. And all you're using for fuel is little tiny sticks. So you don't need big logs, you don't need anything. I have a friend who cooked an entire pancake breakfast for a whole Boy Scout troop on just one rocket stove with just pine cones that he'd gathered that morning. So this is extremely efficient on fuel usage. So I highly recommend a rocket stove. Again, costs a little bit of money, anywhere from about $8,200 to have a rocket stove, but this is something that you can store and have to really give you some peace of mind. All right, the last one is called stove in a can. This one is super simple. It's basically just fuel inside of a can. And so you can light it right inside of there. And of course, I'm not going to be able to get it off. But you light it right inside of there, and you put your pot right on top of this, and it cooks. The only thing I found that's not so great about stove in a can is it makes a lot of mess. It's really kind of a sooty kind of fire. But you're using it outside. Remember, all of this happens outside. This doesn't happen inside. So stove in a can is a very compact, concise thing that you could store to use. So lots of different options. Here's the goals for today. All right, so goals for today is, first of all, I just want you to think, what do I need to be able to cook with? Do I need a can opener? Do I need a couple of long-handled utensils? Just what do I need if I'm gonna ever have to cook, you know, without using my normal stove and oven? The second thing I want you to think about is, I need to have one or two of these options. You maybe already have a couple. Remember we talked about an indoor fireplace, a barbecue grill, a fire pit outside. You maybe already have one. So pick a second. If I were to choose, my top ones would be rocket stove because it takes such little fuel, solar oven because it takes no fuel, but it's a little more expensive, butane stove, cheap as dirt, but you have to store the fuel, or a thermal cooker. Those are my favorite. These are the four right here are my four favorites. If you have to pick one, I would pick one of those to start with because you're gonna get the most bang for your buck and the most bang for your fuel out of those. Something that people often talk to me about too is, I don't know how I would cook with any of these things. We talked about this in an earlier video, but I want to reiterate, on the website are links for a cookbook that I created. It's called the Mega Food Storage Cookbook, and it has all sorts of recipes, everything from recipes that use only food storage to how to use wheat. There's even something called wheat meat on there, all kinds of things that you can use wheat for, how to use it properly. All the way up to recipes that you can use now that when you have a few more ingredients. So check out the links on that. You can actually send it to CopyTech in Pleasant Grove or just call them up and they have all my links there as well. And you can just say, please bind it. It's usually about $15 and you can get that totally bound. So this is cooking. I know that was a lot of information. Like I said, just filtered down to I just want to do one or two things this month. So hopefully you learned a thing or two and we'll see you next month.